Aparna can come back on video. She's her videos up.
स्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणी विद्यारम्भं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा पद्मपत्र विशालाक्षी पद्मकेसरवर्णिनी नित्यं पद्मालयां देवी सामान् पातु सरस्वती भगवती
Hi, good evening and good day to those of you who are not on the Indian time zone. It gives me great pleasure to bring to you the IACI webinar April session on amyloid cardiomyopathy. clinical diagnosis, which is not as rare as we initially suspected. We have a wonderful team from CMC Vellore to share their insights. And in keeping with the IAC's expertise and motto to basically enhance your training, we have both the clinical cardiology team, the nuclear medicine, and the radiology team from CMC Vellore. So it gives me great pleasure to invite Dr. P. Shirish Chandra Srinath, who is from cardiology on the screen dais. He did his undergraduation from Gandhi Medical College in Hyderabad, and he did his MD from Osmania Medical College. He then did his cardiology and then an electrophysiology fellowship, both from Vellore, and has stayed on in Vellore, CMC Vellore, in the EP department. His interests include heart failure and electrophysiological changes in arrhythmias. He has more than 13 papers to his credit. He's also a computer programmer, which is quite a fascinating thing in this day and age. He also likes to travel, and he enjoys a little bit of light reading on his free time. The second person I'd like to invite on the screen dais is Dr. Aparna Irodi, Aparna Shyam. And she is a professor of radiology at CMC Vellore. She is a good friend of mine, has been in CMC for a long period of time, has over 79 papers to her name. And it started perhaps in her early days with what to do and what not to do in radiology, viva voce. And now she's writing book chapters and very interesting documentaries on cardiac imaging and cardiovascular shunt. So she has a huge range of expertise. Not only that, she's also the secretary of the Society of Chest Imaging and Intervention in India and an active executive member of the IACI. Welcome, Aparna. The third person is from the Department of Nuclear Medicine, the professor of nuclear medicine and the head of the department, Dr. Julie Hepzibah. I would like to invite her onto the screen dais. She has been at CMC for a long time, and she has over 35 papers to her credit. She has a wide range of interests, including not just the diagnostic aspects of nuclear medicine, but also in the treatment aspects of nuclear medicine. She enjoys traveling, books, and she has a fantastic voice. She's part of multiple choirs, and she enjoys singing in her free time. And the CMC motto, I think, is well known to all of you: not to be ministered unto, but to minister. And it is our great privilege to have the CMC team walk us through amyloid through excellence in education, service, and research. So without further ado, I would invite Dr. P. Shirish Chandra Srinath to give us his first talk on the clinical aspects of cardiac amyloid. Over to you, Dr. Srinath. Dr. Shirish Chandra.
Thank you, sir. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah. Yes, we can see your screen.
So, good evening to each of you. So I'll straight away start the talk after that introduction by Dr. Sanjay. So I'll be speaking basically about the clinical aspects of cardiac amyloidosis. To put it in the context, I'll start with the nature of amyloid, a brief pathophysiology of amyloidosis, the major types of amyloidosis, and then the more important clinical aspects, when to suspect, the diagnostic pathways, and what were the recent advances in the treatment of amyloidosis. Okay, to start with, amyloid, as you all know, is actually a misnomer. Amyloid actually means starch in Latin, but later it has been identified that amyloid is actually a proteinaceous substance. So basically, the protein remnants after metabolism of certain proteins have a tendency to form this typical structure of amyloid. So amyloid is not a single chemical entity, but actually a structural entity with different chemical, different remnants of different various proteins. Almost more than 50 types of proteins have been described in amyloidosis. So under certain conditions, these amyloid protein remnants can form oligomers, and they can go on to form this so-called protofilaments and typical what we call as beta-plated sheets. And these are called the amyloid fibrils, which aggregate to form so-called amyloid plaques. Now these deposit in the extracellular tissues in the right conditions, and they can be directly cytotoxic to cells through various mechanisms. I won't go into the details of this. So basically, amyloid is can be any of the proteins remnants. So the most common amyloidosis that we encounter are based on their chemical nature. If it's light chain, it's we all know that it's AL amyloidosis. The second most probably is serum protein, also called secondary amyloidosis. And transthyretin amyloidosis is much less common. However, the involvement of heart in light chain amyloidosis is much more common than in secondary amyloidosis, where it's very rare to involve the heart. And transthyretin amyloidosis, depending on the type, has variable involvement of the heart, and kidney involvement is rare. So overall, when you think of heart cardiac amyloidosis, it boils down to two things. One is AL amyloidosis or ATTR amyloidosis. Now, we'll straight away go into the clinical aspects of amyloidosis. So there are two groups of patients who we routinely encounter, who we evaluate for amyloidosis. One group of patients are already being treated for hematological abnormalities, most commonly the plasma cell dyscrasias. They are referred for us to us for evaluation of possible amyloidosis. So in those situations, it's not very difficult. It's just straightforward. We just screen with an echo. But I'll be discussing mostly about the patients who present with cardiac abnormalities and where the amyloidosis has to be suspected. If you think when to suspect, unless you have a high index of suspicion, it's very difficult to evaluate. You won't even think of evaluating amyloidosis, but with more and more data coming in, more and more cardiologists are becoming aware of amyloidosis. So one of the first most common presentations is, as you all know, heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So some of these patients have systemic features of amyloidosis, some of them do not have, but this is by far the most common presentation. So whenever there is a patient with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, amyloidosis is a suspicion. The other presentations are patients with arrhythmias, conduction abnormalities, who typically present with syncope, and who have an unexplained left ventricular hypertrophy on echocardiogram. This forms another group of patients who we should strongly suspect amyloidosis and have to evaluate for the amyloidosis. Third group of patients, much less encountered or probably much less diagnosed, is a group of patients with repeated chest discomfort who come to emergency or chest pain units with mild troponin elevation, and angiogram shows no obstructive coronary artery disease, and echo shows mild unexplained left ventricular hypertrophy. This form another group of patients with and finally, now we are learning more and more about patients with aortic stenosis and associated cardiac amyloidosis, so which is not that uncommon. So, and it has important implications in terms of treatment and decision making. So probably these are the four important scenarios in which we should suspect amyloidosis in, from cardiology perspective. Now, we'll just go into the heart failure, which is by far the most common. And AL amyloidosis has a slightly younger onset, median age of 65 years, whereas most patients are more than 40 years, with very rare individuals having less than 40 years. Whereas transthyretin-related amyloidosis can be of two types. One is the wild type, which is non-mutated protein, which presents much later. It's thought that it's probably an abnormal aging process itself which produces this kind of amyloidosis, because amyloidosis without any manifestation or any clinical manifestation is quite often seen in multiple diseases. So probably this is an aging process that has accelerated or somehow become pathological. So this wild type of amyloidosis, the median age of presentation is usually 75 years. Most of them are over 60 years. Whereas another group of patients within the transthyretin amyloid is a patient with a mutant or hereditary type of, where the transthyretin is has mutations. More than 50 types of mutations have been described, and depending on what type of mutation, they have variable presentation or manifestations. So they can range from presenting at 30 years to 80 years of age with variable involvement of organs. So just as a illustrative case, this is a 56-year-old female who presented with 12 months history of progressive heart failure. And she had no other systemic features. So when the patient presents with that heart failure, so we always look at whether there are any systemic features of amyloidosis. So systemic features are much common EL amyloidosis compared to ATTR amyloidosis. We all know that the involvement of multi-organ involvement in AL amyloidosis. In ATTR amyloidosis, the predominant involvement apart from the heart can be peripheral nervous system, especially compressive neuropathies. So almost 50% of them give history of carpal tunnel syndrome. Some of them give history of sensory neural deafness, lumbar canal stenosis, and tender ruptures. So systemic features are more common in AL amyloidosis, much less common in ATTR amyloidosis, but they can still be seen. So at this stage, when patient presents with heart failure, unexplained heart failure with or without systemic features, most commonly when we have without systemic features, that's when our diagnostic challenge increases. So the first thing we would like to see is an electrocardiogram. We all know the characteristic features of electrocardiogram, where it is low voltages, which by definition is less than 5 millimeters in the limb leads and less than 1 millimeter. Here it's characteristically low voltages in the limb leads. So this discrepancy between the echocardiographic left ventricular hypertrophy and low voltages on ECG was one of the hallmarks of cardiac amyloidosis. However, it's seen in only about 60% of patients with AL amyloidosis. Only a minority of patients with ATTR amyloidosis exhibit this low voltages. In fact, 30% of ATTR amyloidosis can have left ventricular hypertrophy or IVCG, depending on what type of mutation or how much is the deposition of ATTR. Now, pathological QAs are also a hallmark of seen in about 70% of ATTR. Just as illustration, this is another patient with gross changes of interventricular conduction defects, left ventricular hypertrophy criteria, meeting left ventricular hypertrophy criteria. So another patient with extremely low voltages and pathological QAs in the inferior leads. So atrial fibrillation is also quite common. It's more than what you expect in that age group, despite it being in elderly population, seen about 15% of patients. It's much, much more common in patients with ATTR amyloidosis, seen in about 40%, versus AL amyloidosis, it's seen about much less common, 9%. I will just go to the echocardiography. So the hallmark of amyloidosis, echocardiography and amyloidosis, as you all know, is left ventricular hypertrophy. The thickness of the left ventricular hypertrophy is more concentric in patients with AL amyloidosis, whereas ATTR amyloidosis have much thicker walls as well as they have more asymmetric presentation. So the so-called sigmoid septum of the elderly is one of the descriptions which was described long back. Probably some of these patients would have had ATTR amyloidosis, especially if they have been associated with other clinical features. Now, another feature is the RV wall thickness, thickening of the right ventricular wall. So one of the differential diagnoses we quite often face when we see a patient with LVHS, obviously hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and hypertensive heart disease. So this RV wall thickening can be a subtle indicator that it's more likely to be infiltrative or basic cardiomyopathy than purely related to afterload related. So RV thickening can help us in making a reasonable assessment whether it's likely to be hypertensive heart disease or not. Now the other features are atrial dilatation, which are seen in this patient, the increased echogenicity, small pericardial effusion. This is slightly more than usual, but usually typically patients have small pericardial effusion, and valve thickenings and interatrial septal thickening. So none of these features are specific to amyloidosis. So they can be mimicked by hypertensive heart disease or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So, but presence of pericardial effusion with other features falling into place and presence of interatrial septal thickening do point towards more likely to be amyloid. So there's this interatrial septal thickness in the lower image, the pericardial effusion. The increased echogenicity was once considered to be a relatively specific marker, but now it is known that it is not uncommon to see it in other diseases, especially like patients with end-stage renal disease who have very typical presentation like this, pericardial effusions, LVH, and increased echogenicity. So coming to the Doppler. So almost all patients have, especially who are symptomatic, should have a diastolic dysfunction, which is either grade 2 or more. Some of these advanced cases have restrictive filling patterns. And one of the most important feature is reduction in all tissue Doppler velocities. So this so-called 5-5-5 sign, where the systolic, early diastolic, as well as the atrial wave are all reduced. And the severely reduced A wave has been associated with decreased atrial contractility and has been associated with increased risk of stroke. So the stroke volume, again, if you measure the stroke volume index, that's again a prognostic factor in cases of amyloidosis, where the lower stroke volume index can again indicate a poor prognosis. Now, when you assess the right atrial pressure, most of these patients have pulmonary hypertension and right atrial, right ventricular involvement and right heart disease, right heart failure. So the other feature is presence of a dilated and non-collapsible IVC with raised right atrial pressure. So all these features are flawed in amyloidosis. Most of the times, these are seen in patients with advanced disease. And once they reach this stage, it's unlikely to miss any of those diagnoses. But in case of subtle presentations where all of these features do not fit, the strain imaging has become the go-to modality to identify, to differentiate between amyloidosis and other differential diagnosis. So there is a reduced global longitudinal strain despite the preserved ejection fraction. And this hallmark is a relative sparing of the apical strain. So the apical segmental strain, the speckle tracking strain, is preserved there. So you get that on the bullseye plot, you get an appearance of so-called cherry on top. And this appearance has been found to have sensitivity of 93% and specificity of 82% in patients to diagnose amyloidosis. So the usual apical to basal ratio more than 2, the strain ratios more than 2:1 is a feature of amyloidosis. It's an important diagnostic point to differentiate between hypertensive heart disease and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, both of which usually have a global reduction or a preserved global strain. The apical sparing is one feature which can help differentiate. So the end of your echocardiography, so you can basically categorize patients with heart failure into no features of amyloidosis where there's no LVH, normal tissue Doppler velocities, or near normal tissue Doppler velocities, and no atrial enlargement. And the other extreme is where it's strongly suggestive of amyloidosis. So, but most of these patients, already we have a priori information that these are likely to be amyloidosis because of the extracardiac manifestations or because of the other biochemical features. So ultimately, a majority of patients fall in this equivocal cases where the hypertensive heart disease and HCM are important differential diagnosis to be considered. So in practice, a majority of patients will require cardiac magnetic resonance, CMR, which Dr. Aparna will be discussing about. So at the end of clinical assessment and imaging, so what we have established is, and probably if you add MRI to it, you are certain to have a diagnosis of most likely have a cardiac amyloidosis. So this patient has heart failure with cardiac amyloidosis. Now, we all know that it could be because of AL or ATTR. Till about maybe a few years back, the differentiation between AL and ATTR was more important because AL had a disease-modifying treatment. So AL has chemotherapy, which can alter the prognosis, whereas ATTR, once it's diagnosed, it's almost nothing that could have been done, except in rare cases where liver transplant was prescribed. Otherwise, there was nothing much could be done about ATTR amyloidosis. So our aim earlier was mainly, and still in India, most of the times, it's mainly to rule in AL and see whether we can or rule out AL amyloidosis. So we all know that because it's light chain disease, we have to establish that there is increased circulating monoclonal light chain. So demonstrating that circulated excess monoclonal light chain can be done by one of these three tests. So we use serum-free light chain assay, serum electrophoresis, or union immunofixation electrophoresis. Individually, each of these tests have about 70 to 80% sensitivity. But when combined, especially SIFE or urine immunofixation electrophoresis with serum free light chain, the sensitivity is close to 95%. When we use all three, the sensitivity is close to 100%. So the first step after diagnosing heart failure due to amyloidosis would be to do a combination of these tests. Usually in most patients, depending on the situation, we do at least two, and sometimes probably we have to do three. So once SIFE or a combination of these tests are all negative, so that means we have established that there are hardly any light chain circulating. So this makes AL amyloidosis very unlikely. So when it almost rules out AL amyloidosis. So what is left is ATTR amyloidosis. So in this case, the patient had a serum free light chain of a kappa of 35.5, lambda of 1326. So sometimes in polyclonal increase, like other inflammatory disorders, there can be increase in kappa and lambda chain, but the ratio of kappa versus lambda is important. Normally is around 0.26 to 1.65. So the increase or very significantly decreased ratio usually indicates a monoclonal increase. So in this patient, they had a patient had a monoclonal bandwidth lambda positive. Now, sorry. So as I said, if it is negative, we almost always rule out amyloidosis. But if it is positive, we cannot directly establish a diagnosis of amyloidosis for several reasons, which I'll be discussing now. So if that this demonstrate that there is circulating light chain, then there are two possibilities. One, it could be just unrelated to the cardiac disease. Two, it could be amyloidosis still, but it may not be related to circulating light chain. Unless it's very extreme light chain ratios like 100 or almost zero. So in those situations, it's possible, but generally we have to establish a tissue diagnosis of amyloidosis in patients with AL, in circulating light chain. So the next thing obviously we do is bone marrow biopsy. So the problem with bone marrow biopsy is there can be a whole spectrum of patients with normal to significantly elevated plasma cells. So when it's more than 10% plasma cells, it's multiple, it's by definition called multiple myeloma. And if they have other bone markers or other features of multiple myeloma, they obviously go directly into treatment for multiple myeloma. These are not the patients usually we do not evaluate for amyloid, tissue diagnosis of amyloid. So the other group of patients whose bone marrow can be normal or very mild, minimal changes, they by themselves do not warrant any treatment. The so-called monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance do not warrant any treatment. So these patients do have plasma cells that are not significantly increased in number, but do produce light chains that are in significant proportion. So even with a normal bone marrow biopsy, a patient can still be producing a significant amount of light chain to produce AL amyloidosis. So that's the reason why. And second thing is this MGUS is sometimes seen commonly in elderly individuals without much clinical manifestation. So there can be overlap between the cardiac manifestations of some other disease and MGUS together, so that we need to establish that actually this is the one that is causing the amyloidosis. So one advantage of bone marrow is sometimes 60% of the cases, the amyloidosis deposits can be seen in the bone marrow itself. So in which case the diagnosis, at least we have established that the amyloid, the disease is probably amyloidosis. In cases where we don't see bone marrow deposits of amyloidosis, the second is we have to do a biopsy of any other site. Most common which we follow is a fat pad or a rectal mucosal biopsy. The liver, kidney and heart are involved. Depending on involvement, if they are done, it reaches almost 100% sensitivity. But if it's fat pad with bone marrow alone, the sensitivity is around 80%. Now, because amyloid patients also have significant bleeding diathesis and also the cost and the risk, generally these are reserved for patients who do not demonstrate fat pad or bone marrow amyloidosis. Now, in a patient with circulating light chains, patient with amyloidosis, the most probable diagnosis is AL amyloidosis, but still a typing of amyloid is recommended because there may be a proportion of patients who, despite because of the same reason that MGUS can be associated with just circulating light chains, the amyloid may be different from the MGUS. So typing of amyloid is recommended. So the most what we do in our institution is immunohistochemistry. But the problem with it is most of the times it comes as the pathologists and hematologists feel that it's equivocal immunohistochemistry. But despite that, they use degree of empiricism and go ahead and treat patients with this group of patients with where the typing is not done. For gold standard for typing, maybe you need a spectrophotometry or electron microscopy, which are not easily available. Sometimes they send it overseas to overseas lab for spectrophotometry in a given patient. But it's recommended, but sometimes it's not always done. Now, in this case, bone marrow biopsy showed 6% plasmacytosis and fat pad biopsy showed amyloid deposits. However, the amyloid typing was not done, but because given the scenario and relatively in the presentation at 56 years of age, they went ahead and treated her for AL amyloidosis. So this is the overall diagnostic pathway. So when you suspect clinically and via imaging that there is cardiac amyloidosis, the first thing once you do a electrophoresis and serum free light chains, if it is negative, it rules out AL amyloidosis and you go into the pathway to diagnose ATTR amyloidosis. So if it is positive, you need a tissue diagnosis. First usually is fat pad with bone marrow. If there are no amyloid deposits, finally we'll have to do a endomyocardial biopsy. A small proportion of patients do require endomyocardial biopsy. And if there are amyloid deposits, it's ideal to type it and say that it's ATTR. Still with light chain circulating, it could still be ATTR amyloidosis. But this step is not commonly done and there is amount of empiricism that is in, at least followed in our institution. So if there is normal electrophoresis, so most of these patients do not require a biopsy. So we'll go into a technetium pyrophosphate scan and Dr. Julie will be speaking about that. And then we'll have to do a genetic testing, the importance of which is slightly emerging because of the new therapies that are coming into picture. This is a second case where it's a 60-year-old female presented with fatigue, occasional dizziness, no features of heart failure. She had some vague abdominal pain and tingling and numbness of the right palm at night, which is suggestive of carpal tunnel syndrome. The immunofixation electrophoresis and free chain were negative. Echo showed mild LVH, normal LV function, small pericardial effusion. And the ECG was showing atrial fibrillation, low voltages all through, and slow ventricular response despite not on any drugs. This combination is more, we are seeing more and more of this combination in patients with amyloidosis, or probably when you see this AF with slow ventricular rate without any drugs, we should think of amyloidosis, especially with these low voltages, because amyloidosis also affects the conduction system, thereby decreasing the ventricular response to AF. This patient underwent technetium pyrophosphate, which was about grade 2 uptake with the contralateral heart to contralateral lung ratio of more than 1.5. So technetium pyrophosphate scan, especially if it is grade 3 or in some cases grade 2 or more, is diagnostic and you don't need any further biopsy to diagnose ATTR amyloidosis. So there are another group of patients who we have to suspect amyloidosis is patients with aortic stenosis. So in these patients, patients with history, when do we say in multiple series, there are almost 4% to 29% of AS patients can have a coexisting ATTR. And the prognosis after surgery or TAVR is very, very poor compared to patients who do not have amyloidosis. So for that obvious reason, we need to be aware of this condition. And most importantly, we should look at the history is usually an indicator where presence of carpal tunnel syndrome, as we discussed, it's almost 50% give a carpal tunnel syndrome history or lumbar canal stenosis. Where the heart failure is disproportionate to the aortic stenosis severity or there are significant right heart features, failure features. And the LVH is disproportionate to the severity of AS. A subgroup of patients with probably low flow, low gradient AS do have amyloidosis and we have to look at that. and patients who have conduction abnormalities and premature pacemaker implantation and the ECG voltage discrepancy, all these features point towards amyloidosis, coexisting amyloidosis, and these are the patients who should we should evaluate for amyloidosis because of the significant therapeutic and prognostic implications in aortic stenosis. Now, coming to the prognostic markers, most prognostication depends upon NT-proBNP, cardiac troponins, and free light chains and renal involvement. By far, the most commonly used in different prognostic scores are NT-proBNP and cardiac troponins. So, if they are elevated, they portend a poorer prognosis. So, in patients, there are multiple scoring systems. One is most commonly used is Mayo Clinic. The other is the Boston group, which looks at only the troponin I and the BNP, and the median survival rate in very extreme, the poorest prognosis patients is only about 2 years or less than 2 years, and whereas the best prognosis patient is close to more than 6 or 7 years. So based on the troponin and BNP, we do prognosticate patients with amyloidosis. In ATTR amyloidosis, again, the same thing, it's a troponin based, essential on troponin and NT-proBNP. And of course, if there's a renal involvement, based on the renal involvement. Now, treatment from cardiac perspective, patients, the most important aspect is that most of these patients, because of heart failure, will be on beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, and aldosterone antagonists. So, but they tolerate beta blockers and digoxin poorly. One, because of the decreased rate, they do not tolerate lower heart rates because to maintain a decreased stroke, because of the decreased stroke volume, they need a higher heart rate to maintain the cardiac output. Second, the digoxin can have interaction with amyloid fibril and can have toxicity. So these are the important things that we need to stop beta blockers and digoxin. And most patients have autonomic dysfunction, so they have orthostasis, hypotension with ACE inhibitors. So all this needs to stop and closely address the conduction system abnormalities. Prophylactic pacing is being advocated in many patients who had syncope and evidence of intraventricular conduction defects. Maintain a higher heart rate by stopping beta blockers, and most patients who have an indication for anticoagulation, they have very high risk of stroke, so anticoagulations are a must. Now coming to the therapy proper, the AL amyloidosis, there's chemotherapy, effective chemotherapy, depending on what stage of disease they have results, as we have seen. But unfortunately, patients who present very late despite chemotherapy do very poorly. Autologous BMT is not usually advocated in our institution because of the poor prognosis once the heart is involved significantly. Now, the most advanced happened with ATTR amyloidosis. In the last 2 years, there has been advance in terms of new drugs that have come to stabilize the amyloid so there is no further deposition of amyloidosis. One of the first drugs is the tafamidis, which acts on the folding of the protein. So this is useful in both wild type amyloidosis as well as the hereditary or mutant ATTR amyloidosis. Whereas the patisiran and inotaseran were studied mostly in patients with hereditary ATTR. So because of this, we need to be aware that we should diagnose and try to subtype, which we have not been doing, at least most of the places in India, we have not been subtyping ATTR. But there is probably in the next few years, we need to concentrate on that and subtype these patients with ATTR amyloidosis, wild type and hereditary type. And earlier, in hereditary type with not much involvement of the heart, liver transplantation can be useful, but not useful in wild type ATTR. Okay, that's in brief. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shirish Chandrasena. That was a wonderful walkthrough about cardiac amyloid, the clinical presentation. You took us through the distribution, the classification between ATTR and AL, you described sigmoid septum of the elderly, and you also described certain interesting things for us, such as relative sparing of the apical strain and many other important things in terms of treatment as well. We do have a couple of questions from the audience. And one of the questions is, how common is it for us to see cardiac amyloid in general in India? Distribution? Can you discuss that a little bit for us?
Yeah, I mean, so I did not find much of literature in terms of papers published on the incidence of amyloidosis, but our experience here has been that the AL amyloidosis is much more common here because we have a robust hematology department which takes care of AL. So we treat a lot of AL. We do encounter AL patients. The ATT amyloidosis probably is underdiagnosed. Our awareness is increasing for the past few years that all these groups of patients. So probably it's underdiagnosed, but the more we, and second thing is the inertia, because there was no effective treatment till recently. So there was not much impetus to diagnose ATTR amyloidosis. But now that we have effective therapies and in few years probably they may become more affordable, we probably should concentrate on diagnosing these patients. By the time they come, we should be ready with the diagnosis in most patients. So ATTR is probably underdiagnosed, and I do not know the true incidence of ATTR. I do not find any literature in Indian perspective.
Right. You also mentioned that heart failure with ejection fraction is one of the presentations of amyloid. So do you find yourself, you give a nice flow chart in terms of how you approach it. Do you find anything else that you would from your own personal experience, which you use to send patients for cardiac MR?
So as I said, sir, for patients undergo cardiac MR for the reason that if the patient is obviously from known plasma cell dyscrasia and you find this, probably you would not send. Any patients with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, despite an obvious diagnosis of all these features, long-term strain, we do send for cardiac MR.
Okay. The other question that came up was in terms of the reason for the apical sparing that you mentioned, and also the low voltage ECG. So perhaps you can give us a pathological understanding of why the apex is spared in amyloid, and perhaps why you get low ECG, low voltage ECGs.
The explanation for low voltage is not much simpler. So amyloid is basically extracellular deposition disease. It does not affect the myocytes. Even though there is increased thickening of the ventricular wall, it is mostly because of the extracellular deposition. There is no hypertrophy or hyperplasia of the muscle cells. So the electrical activity is only because of the cardiac myocytes. There is no interstitium that does not add to the electrical activity of the heart. So because of the extracellular deposition, there is what you call the cell-to-cell coupling of the electrical activity is much reduced. So the electrical activity does not happen normally as it happens to a normal syncytium, because there's a lot of barrier. So there's a lot of stuttering or slowing down of the conduction. So because of these both reasons, there is decreased voltage. So, and the obvious left ventricular hypertrophy because of deposition. So there's a discrepancy between that deposition and the voltage. That's one of the features which should point towards a diagnosis of amyloidosis. The reason for apical sparing is not very clear. Dr. Jesu is, who is a cardiographer in our institution, if he's here, probably can add to that. Based on other studies, other diseases, normally the contraction of the left ventricle starts from the base to apex in this thing. So in other diseases, the maximum load is seen in the apex. There is some distribution discrepancy in the apex to base distribution of the strain wall stress in patients with afterload increase. But exact reason is I'm not aware of that. Maybe Dr. Jesu can add to that if he's around.
I don't know whether he is, but if he is, please do type in your response, sir. We'll be happy to listen to you as well. We had one other question, which was in regard to the association of cardiac and extracardiac amyloid. My own personal experience with patients with multiple myeloma, for example, has been that we wouldn't be able to diagnose accurately or confidently whether they had cardiac amyloid just because they had some, they had biopsies elsewhere, or we would find the cardiac imaging MR to be negative in patients, even though they had amyloid depositions elsewhere from biopsies. So and you mentioned there was about a 70% reliability, I think is what you mentioned. So when do you actually refer patients for cardiac biopsy in your flowchart?
Patients with multiple myeloma?
Anybody. So when is, or what threshold do you have to refer patients for biopsy, and what threshold do you use for just accepting maybe a CMR or
In all patients, we do bone marrow and SAT-PAT. The endomyocardial biopsy, only if the hematologist feels that it is very, very unlikely to be a AL amyloidosis, where his doubt has been raised that he has a doubt whether this is a different form of amyloidosis or truly, that's the situation where endomyocardial biopsy. But in most patients, we just go ahead with bone marrow and SAT-PAT biopsy. When the hematologist feels that the chance of it to be an AL amyloidosis is less likely, that's when we go ahead and do the endomyocardial biopsy, despite being after the CMR.
Right. So if you had a CMR which looked like it was consistent with an amyloid-type distribution on, say, the delayed enhancement on the mapping, would you still go ahead and do the biopsy in that situation, or does the biopsy precede the reason to get the cardiac MR?
No, the biopsy will always follow the cardiac MR, sir. So once we have established, I mean, it's mainly for the typing or establishing that it's actually AL, or if at all we are to do an AL or ATTR amyloidosis. So once the light chains are present and cardiac amyloidosis on MRI is there, so, and if the hematologist feels that the there is discrepancy between the plating light chains and the cardiac amyloidosis, that's when we go ahead and do it. But otherwise, if MRI shows obvious amyloidosis features and there is some cell dyscrasia or circulating light chain, and one of these modalities shows a biopsy, or the hematologist says it's very likely, we do not do an endomyocardial biopsy. So ideally, it should be done, but because of the some amount of empiricism, probably the hematologist, if he feels clinically confident that it's likely to be AL, we do not do amyloidosis. But if you see this, actually, whatever imaging-based or clinical-based cardiac amyloidosis, if there is positive immunoglobulin, even then you have to do biopsy in all the patients. It is the fat and bone marrow. And if this is not contributing, no amyloid deposits, they have to ultimately do endomyocardial biopsy. This step probably is not done in our study because the hematologist probably will use his empirical or clinical knowledge and goes directly to the AL. But ideally, yes, it should be done as well.
And I guess the last question I have for you is with regard to just how accurate or how well our reports are when we discuss cardiac MR. Obviously, you work in a center which has got experts reporting the cases, but if you had to tell us or advise us as to what you would want to see in your reports, in our cardiac MRI reports, which would help you with your clinical evaluation and treatment, what would you want to see in the reports? Obviously, the presence or absence of amyloid is something that you is the first line in the impression, but what else would you like to see in the report?
Most often what happens, we have a meet between radiology and cardiology once or twice. So we do discuss the cases there. So more than relying on the report, we actually have a direct discussion with the radiology team and come to a consensus. So that clears a lot of doubts. Apart from the standard, even if it's reported standard way, we do have doubts based on it's a way of learning both ways. That probably is important in terms of learning for us as well as for them.
Okay. So thank you, Dr. Shirish Chandra. That was a wonderful talk. Again, we thank you for your participation today. Our next speaker is going to be Dr. Aparna, and she is going to be speaking on the cardiac MR evaluation in amyloidosis. Aparna, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjaya. I'm hoping that you can hear and see.
Yes, we can see it clearly, Aparna.
Thank you. So I'll just be talking about the MRI in cardiac amyloidosis. So Dr. Suresh has told us extensively about all the clinical scenarios and how AL and ATTR are the common ones that can affect the heart. So I'll just directly go into the MRI findings. As an overview, I thought we will discuss about the typical findings, a little bit discussion on not so typical findings, whether we can differentiate AL and ATTR based on MRI. Are there any prognostic indicators on MRI? We heard about the clinical prognostic indicators. I'm just going to imaging prognostic indicators and the imaging differentials. So let's start off with the typical findings. So under typical, if we look at the morphology, as was discussed in ECHO also, the main thing that we will see is the LV wall thickening or hypertrophy. And typically it is supposed to be concentric and symmetric, but many times we do see that it can be asymmetric, but typical is concentric LV hypertrophy. In addition, we can also see RV wall thickening, which may or may not be there. We can see interatrial septal thickening. We can see RA or LA wall thickening. So interatrial septal thickness more than 6 millimeters is supposed to be abnormal and is supposed to be quite specific for amyloidosis. Even the valves may look thickened. So when we are telling about the interatrial septal thickening, we should be careful because sometimes there can be fat infiltration. So when there is fat, usually in our SSFP images, we will be able to see the chemical shift artifact, which can alert us to say that it is fat and not the amyloid deposition. Next, coming to the function. So as Dr. Suresh said, most commonly they are heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So ejection fraction per se may not be a good way to diagnose amyloidosis, but we do see sometimes low ejection fractions. Diastolic dysfunction is more important than the systolic dysfunction, and clinically ECHO is more capable of diagnosing the diastolic dysfunction rather than MR, although there are a lot of ways of diagnosing this on MR as well, but clinically mostly it's done on ECHO. So on MR, they say that the low LV volumes are a better indicator than actually the ejection fraction. So end diastolic, end systolic volumes can be low, and that helps us more than the actual ejection fraction. And of course, the function by myocardial strain. So again, on MR myocardial strain, the typical apical sparing can be there with impaired strain in the base and mid regions. We don't have much experience with strain, but MR strain can also be done. Next is the important point of tissue characterization. So under tissue characterization, we have three things to our that can come to our help. One is the TI scout images. Next is the late gadolinium enhanced images. And then the parametric T1, T2, and ECV mappings. So let's start off with the TI scout. So we know normally, as we do the late gadolinium enhanced images, we do it on the inversion recovery sequences. And for that, we do the TI scout or the look locker sequences, where we do increasing TI values. With increasing TI values, we take images, and normal nulling pattern will be that the blood nulls first. So these are the TI values here. So as the TI values are increasing, you can see that the blood nulls first, and then followed by the myocardium, which nulls at a later time. So in amyloidosis, the typical thing described is the coincident or reverse nulling pattern. So in this, we can see that the myocardium and blood are almost nulling together. Whereas on this, we can see that the myocardium is nulling first, after which the blood has nulled. So this is one important thing that helps us. So this was Dr. Sanjaya's paper in 2013, which has been quoted so many times because it's such a important paper, which helps. And anybody can do this, even if we don't have the mapping. All of us have this look locker sequence and the inversion recovery sequence, and we can use this to diagnose amyloidosis, and it has a very good specificity. We also, in our institute, we did look at one more point about the TI scout images. So as we know that it is difficult to get a proper TI scout and proper TI time of nulling and take proper LG images. So there are papers which say that if we take images at an earlier time, instead of 10 minutes post-GADO, if we take it 5 minutes post-GADO, we may be able to get better images. So we kept doing this at 3, 5, 7, and 10 minutes. And then we actually look back at these and we try to see whether there is a difference in the nulling pattern at different time points. So we did see that there is a difference. So almost all the patients whom we have diagnosed as amyloid on imaging, they all had a reverse nulling pattern on 10 minutes, but many of them did not have a reverse nulling pattern at 5 minutes or 3 minutes. So we thought that maybe those who have earlier onset of reverse nulling pattern, that is, even if they have reverse nulling at 3 minutes or 5 minutes, that means probably they have a higher load of amyloid. And we compared that with the LB mass, and we showed that there is more LB mass in people who have an earlier onset of reverse nulling pattern. At the same time, we also thought that if we are going to use the reverse nulling pattern to help us diagnose amyloid, we should not use the earlier images. We have to use the later images at 10 minutes or later, because earlier images can have a normal nulling pattern in many cases, unless it is advanced or a high load of amyloid is there. At the same time, we actually proposed that whether this can be used to prognosticate, but there are no real studies and we don't really have follow-up of these patients to say whether this can be used to prognosticate. So this is what actually happens. So this is the reverse. So this is a amyloid patient and this is a normal patient. So in the amyloid patient, we can see that this yellow is the blood and the red is the myocardium. So myocardium, this is the plotting of the signal with the increasing TI values. So as the TI values are increasing, we can see red, that is the myocardium nulls first, followed by the blood pool. Whereas in the normal, it's the blood pool, the yellow is nulling first, followed by the red. And another point that these authors have brought about is that this interval between the nulling of the myocardium and blood is small. That is, soon after myocardium nulls, the blood is also nulling. Very short interval time in amyloidosis compared to normal. I'll just come to this again in the end to show that. Another important thing to remember when we are evaluating the TI scout and doing the LGE is not to take a very early images. So when we do the TI scout, we may be tempted and we may think that this is the nulling of the normal myocardium. And we may try to take the LGE images at the TI of, say, this is 160 milliseconds. So this can give a false image or false negative or a mirror image type of artifact than the true pattern. So actually it is a subendocardial enhancement, but we have taken this value at a low value. That means we are thinking that this subendocardial layer is actually nulled and the mid or subepicardial is enhancing. So we should be careful that we should take a little later, don't take very early pattern. So we know most of the times 10 minutes, it's around 240, 260, that kind of TI values. So if it is too early, we can get a mirror image distortion or a false negative pattern. So another thing to remember is whenever the amyloid is being suspected, we should remember that amyloid is deposited from subendocardial towards the epicardial layer. So actually whatever is the peripheral most, we want to null that. So there will usually be a thin layer of normal myocardium. So we should null the peripheral layer rather than nulling the central subendocardial layer of myocardium. The next tissue characterization thing that we have in our tool that we have is the late gadolinium enhancement. So the typical late gadolinium enhancement, as we all know, is the diffuse global subendocardial enhancement, which is not following any coronary artery pattern with a dark blood pool. So why do we have the subendocardial enhancement? For two reasons. As I said, amyloid starts depositing from subendocardial to epicardial. So that is why in the beginning, in the earlier stages, we can have subendocardial, and later on it can go into a more transmural enhancement. Second reason for the subendocardial enhancement is because amyloid can affect the capillaries and cause ischemia. And as we know, ischemia will start off with the subendocardial layer. And why do we get the dark blood pool? That is because there is an earlier washout of contrast from the blood pool, because of the amyloid in the other tissues. So amyloid, the gadolinium gets distributed to other tissues also where there is amyloid in the peripheral tissues, and that's why the blood gadolinium from blood is cleared earlier, and that is why we get the dark blood pool with diffuse subendocardial enhancement. Again, the enhancement can have the similar apical sparing, where there is more involvement of the bases with less involvement of the apex. And as we said in morphology, we can get RV wall thickening, RV wall enhancement, we can get interatrial septal thickening enhancement, LA, RA walls enhancement, valves can be thickened and enhancing. And as I said, with time from subendocardial, it can go into a transmural enhancement. But what are the issues of using LGE only? Is, as we know, it's very difficult to choose the TI. Sometimes we may not be knowing which exact area to choose, and we can get the false negative results. So to overcome this, two things can be done. One is the PSIR sequence, which is a little for which kind of forgives if you do some mistakes in the choosing of the TI, and taking images at an earlier time, like 5 minutes or 7 minutes. And whenever disease is diffuse, as we know, LGE is kind of geared to bring out the difference between abnormal and normal tissue. So when the tissue is completely normal, completely abnormal, then maybe it is difficult to look for this LGE. And LGE can be seen only in the later stages. And sometimes if there is renal involvement and renal impairment, we may not be able to give GADO. Also, LGE is very difficult to quantify and may not be able to say how much is the load of amyloid based on LGE alone. So because of this, the other mapping are the ones that are more helpful in amyloidosis. So T1, T2, ECV, all can be used. So native T1 and ECV are significantly increased compared to other diseases. So we have this typical picture which everybody uses whenever we are talking about mapping. So we know that amyloid, much higher T1, much higher ECV compared to say HCM or DCM or any other diseases, it is much higher. This is one of our cases where it is a high T1, native T1. So this can actually be used to quantify. So higher the T1 value, we can say that it's probably more the amyloid deposition. And it can also be used in surveillance with treatment. We can see whether the values are reducing. T2 values can be more elevated in AL amyloidosis because this AL, the light chains have some toxic effects also, not just deposition. They have some toxic effects and can cause edema, which can cause a T2 elevation. Next, coming to the associated findings. So we can see small pleural effusions, small pericardial effusions. There can be ascites. And one more point is normally on T2 weighted images, the spleen is usually brighter than the liver. So whenever we see that the spleen is darker than the liver, we should always suspect amyloid. Of course, hemosiderosis is the other thing, but hemosiderosis usually in hemochromatosis, hemosiderosis usually involves the liver also. So when we see that the spleen is dark, always think about whether there can be amyloid. I'll show some examples also later. So now we discussed all the typical findings. Now I just want to go into the not so typical findings. So we thought that the symmetric wall thickening is typical, but many a time we can see asymmetric thickening, and it can be asymmetric septal thickening, which can make it mimic HCM. So many times it can be misdiagnosed as HCM, especially when there is asymmetric septal thickening. Dr. Sirish said about this sigmoid or reverse curve type of septal thickening, and this is more described in ATTR rather than AL amyloidosis. And sometimes we may not have any thickening also. So these can also be there in amyloidosis. And some studies have actually said that 40 to 80%. So it is more common to have asymmetric wall thickening than a concentric thickening. Coming to LGE also, the typical global subendocardial enhancement is the typical form, and the atypical can be patchy, mid-myocardial, sub-epicardial, only a part of the subendocardium involved. All this can be the not so typical things. Short note about advanced techniques, which we don't have much experience with. So MR elastography also has been studied, showing increased stiffness in the myocardium, and MR spectroscopy can show decreased myocardial triglyceride levels. Now, can we differentiate AL and ATTR on imaging? So Dr. Sirish told about the clinical picture differentiation. I'll just go about the imaging. So as I said, the circulating free chain light chains can cause a direct toxicity to the myocytes and cause necrosis. That is why they can be edema. And so AL is the one which can cause T2 elevation. For the same reason, the T1 is higher in AL compared to ATTR, where ECV is higher. So why is ECV higher in ATTR? Because there is generally more material deposition in ATTR. So there is more thickening of the wall and more ECV. But the AL higher in A, sorry, the T1 higher in AL is because of this edema. So T1 and T2 higher in AL because of the edema, whereas ECV is higher in ATTR because generally there is more tissue, more material deposition. So asymmetric hypertrophy is more common in ATTR, and more LV thickening, more involvement of RV, more generally more mass, everything more in ATTR. For the same reason, there is more transmural LG in ATTR compared to AL, where we have the diffuse global subendocardium, whereas ATTR has the transmural involvement. So there is one thing that I came across called as the Kale score. So this is query amyloid late enhancement score, which some people have devised, and they have shown that more than 13 score can have a way of differentiating ATTR and AL. So again, more deposition, so more the score. Briefly, this is a score. Basically, it is just evaluating the extent of LGE. And there is quite a big score given for RV involvement. So there is higher score in ATTR compared to AL. So next, coming to prognostic indicators on imaging. A whole lot of prognostic findings have been, studied to see if they have any prognostic indications in amyloidosis. So basically, I think if we think of it as, is there more involvement, the worse the prognosis. So how, whatever we can say more involvement. So when there is RV involvement, when there is transmural enhancement, when there is more left atrial dilatation, when there is LA wall enhancement, all these are saying that there is a poorer prognosis. So LGE subendocardial versus transmural. So transmural is worse prognosis. People have also studied the difference between the T1 value in the subepicardium and subendocardium. The lesser the difference, that means there is more transmural involvement, again, worse prognosis. So many indices have been studied, including TAPSE, mapping, ECV more than 44% has a poor prognosis. And the Kale score that we saw, more than 9 has a poor prognosis. All these have poor prognosis and a higher mortality. Coming to differentials on imaging, basically the differentials are differentials for whatever is causing LV wall thickening. And the top differential is the HCM or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And last 2-3 cases that I've seen were misdiagnosed as HCM. So we, how do we differentiate HCM and amyloid? We know the typical enhancement pattern in amyloid and typical enhancement pattern in HCM, where we see cloudy, patchy mid-myocardial or insertion point kind of enhancement. HCM can have the LVOT obstruction and SAM, which is not described, which is not seen in amyloidosis. Hypertensive heart disease, other infiltrative conditions like Anderson Fabry. So MRI can very easily differentiate this, where Anderson Fabry has a low T1 value compared to amyloid, which has a very high T1 values. Aortic stenosis, again, Dr. Sirish has pointed that although aortic stenosis with hypertrophy itself can be a differential, many of the patients may have associated ATTR amyloidosis, which have a worse prognosis even after treatment. So again, to differentiate amyloid versus hypertrophic cardiomyopathy based on the mapping, native T1 and ECV are important. But this paper actually quotes that this interval, the small interval between the myocardium and blood nulling time, that is also having a very good prognostic indication, a very good indicator to differentiate between amyloid and HCM. So I just thought I can just show one or two cases. So let me start off with the first case. So this was a 70-year-old lady who had diabetes and hypertension and presented with breathlessness and exertion and pedal edema. On the LFT, there was an AJ reversal. So AJ reversal is one indicator saying that there could be some kind of abnormal proteins in the blood. Echo showed concentric LVH and grade 3 diastolic dysfunction. So because of these two points, amyloidosis was suspected and cardiac MRI was done. Let me just show this MRI. So this is the patient's MRI. This is the first SSFP bright blood, just true axial non-syn images I'm showing. So we can see that there is small bilateral pleural effusions. As we go down, we can see both the atria are quite dilated and we can see quite a bit of LV hypertrophy or LV wall thickening, which is kind of concentric and symmetric and involving all the walls. At some point, maybe the RV is mildly thickened, but not much thickened, and the interatrial septum is not significantly thickened in this patient. So next, let me just show the four-chamber cine. So again, we can see the LV wall concentric thickening, and we can see the volume is reduced, but the function looks like it's preserved. We can see some TR and MR, and we can see the atria dilatation. Here, when we see, we are thinking that there is probably mild interatrial septal thickening here. So LVOT views. We do not see any LVOT obstruction or SAM. And let me just go to the TI scout images. So now I'm just showing the TI scout with increasing values of TI. So as the values of TI is increasing, we can see that the myocardium has nulled. The blood is still having some brightness. Now the myocardium is fully null. Blood is starting to null. Now the blood is actually null. So there is a reversal of the nulling pattern with myocardium nulling before the blood. And if we see the late gadolinium images, we can see this global subendocardial enhancement. It is kind of starting to become transmural in some areas, but definitely subepicardial areas paired. And the blood pool is very dark, again, because the redistribution of gadolinium and the washout of gadolinium from the blood to the other tissues which are having amyloidosis. So this is the four chamber PSIR post gadolinium. We can see that there is the subendocardial, some areas transmural enhancement, but there is apical sparing. So based on everything, we said it's likely to be amyloidosis. And what happened to this patient is later, like Dr. Sirish said, similar things were done. So bone marrow was done, which showed plasma cell dyscrasia. There was a lambda light chain, and in the bone marrow itself, they showed that there was focal vessel amyloid deposits were there. Patient also had proteinuria, indicating that there was renal involvement, but the creatinine was normal. And a patient had other poor prognostic markers in terms of raised troponin T and NT-proBNP. So finally, a diagnosis of plasma cell dyscrasia with cardiac and renal amyloidosis was done. And patient was started on bortezomib-based chemo, which is a proteasome inhibitor. Just another case, this is a 55-year-old gentleman who had breathlessness on exertion. He was diagnosed elsewhere as a non-obstructive HCM based on asymmetric septal hypertrophy. Coronary angiogram was done, which showed only minor disease. And ECG showed low voltage QRS. Again, Dr. Sirish has described about these low voltages. Echo showed LVH with asymmetric septal hypertrophy, diastolic dysfunction, and there was impaired strain also on echo. And the cardiac MR, so again, initial bright blood SSFP non-seen images show quite big bilateral pleural effusions. small pericardial effusion, and we can see the asymmetric septal thickening here with less involvement of the lateral wall. So this is the four-chamber CINI, which again shows the asymmetric septal thickening. There is probably some mild thickening of the RV wall. So this is actually just some volume averaging. Do not mistake this for thickening, but we can see that the left atrial wall is looking thickened here. So because there is asymmetric septal thickening and there is some suspicion of it being hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, definitely the next thing we want to look at is the LVOT view. So again, we see that there is no LVOT obstruction or SAM. There is some MR, but there is no LVOT obstruction. Now, again, I'll just show you the late gadolinium enhancement images. So here we can see that there is transmural enhancement. There is some enhancement of the RV wall also, which is minimally thickened. I'll just show the T1 mapping value. So T1 mapping was very highly elevated. 1080 is on upper limit of normal for us. So 1166, so it was elevated. The ECV was also very elevated. It was 66 was the ECV in this patient. So we have finally said that it is likely to be cardiac amyloidosis rather than HCM, and this patient is under evaluation. Just one last case I will show. This will be of interest to radiologists because of some non-cardiac also involvement. So this is a 66-year-old gentleman who actually presented with not really like cardiac symptoms. He presented with jaundice, abdominal distension, some pedal edema, and it was a long history, some 8 months history, but patient was a little sick when he actually presented to us. So because of this, LFT was done. LFT showed raised alkaline phosphatase, raised bilirubin. He also had some mild proteinuria. Creatinine was normal. So he actually had MRI of the abdomen to look for, because he had raised alkaline phosphatase, we thought it could be some kind of an obstructive jaundice. So what could be causing? Is there some tumor causing the obstruction to the biliary tree? Such thoughts were running, and that is why the MRI of the abdomen was done. So we can see here. So again, like I told previously, we can see that this is the T2-weighted axial image. We can see that the spleen is quite hypo-intense compared to the liver. That itself should alert us to say that there could be amyloidosis here. So there was some minimal biliary dilatation. Patient had a lot of ascites. And when we went up to the sections, which is showing the thorax, we can see that there is pleural effusions, and there was also significant LV wall thickening and hypertrophy. RV wall was also looking quite thickened. So we kind of thought that because of this cardiac involvement, plus that spleen showing very hypo-intense appearance, atria are looking dilated, we kind of raised that there could be there is a high chance of this being amyloidosis. So basically, nobody was actually thinking of amyloidosis until we brought this up, because it was more going more in terms of malignancy causing obstruction to biliary tree, and that kind of direction the evaluation was going in. So then because of the wall thickening, and we suggested to do cardiac MRI. So cardiac MRI was also done. So we can again see that this is more or less a concentric symmetric hypertrophy, and there is mild RV wall thickening also. And again, we can see that the function is not much reduced, but the volumes are reduced. And again, going to the main important sequence, where we can see there is transmural enhancement in the late gadolinium images. So this was actually a 5-minute image, and we can see the 10-minute image also, again showing little bit some areas transmural, some areas subendocardial, and we can see the RV wall also enhancing and the dark blood pool because of washout of gadol from the blood into the other tissues with amyloid. I just wanted to show the TI scout images also. So again, we can see that as the TI values are increasing, we can see first the myocardium is starting to null, myocardium is more nulled, and then the blood is nulling. So there is a reversal of the nulling pattern also. So everything put together, we thought it is very highly likely to be amyloidosis, probably systemic as well as cardiac involvement. So this patient, after this, underwent multiple other investigations. So serum immunofluorescence electrophoresis, which Dr. Sirish had told about, that was done, which showed IgA lambda light chains. Liver biopsy was done because he mainly presented with the liver symptoms, which showed amyloidosis in the liver. Plus, he also had hepatocanalicular cholestasis. That was the reason for his obstructive jaundice. And marked hepatocytic atrophy was also there. Bone marrow was also done, which showed that there was myeloma, and in the bone marrow also there was amyloid deposit. He also had, all this was kind of simultaneously done because we suggested the amyloidosis. He also had rectal biopsy, so that also showed amyloidosis. So he had extensive systemic amyloidosis with cardiac involvement as well. So I want to just summarize saying that we all know the typical findings, but we should remember about the atypical findings, and we should remember how HCM can closely mimic and how we can differentiate HCM from amyloidosis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Aparna. Can you come on the, can you turn your video on, please?
Yes, sure.
So that was an excellent talk, perhaps one of the best I've heard regarding amyloid. I particularly like the way you went step by step in the typical pattern first, and then you moved over to the atypical, and then from prognosis as well. You taught us a lot by, in terms of looking at the interatrial septum, in terms of its thickness. You've shown us multiple cases where TI scout was important and how we should look at the TI scout. You also helped us understand where ECB is important for prognosis. You mentioned greater than 44% as a prognostic quantifying factor. And you also described how to differentiate it from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So pretty much, I think you've answered most of the questions that the audience have, but we do have some interesting questions. And one of the questions that was asked was, because the inversion time of amyloid is so difficult, do you end up relying on PSIR most of the time, or do you try to pick a null point from the TI scout and then run that, and then of course use the PSIR images to make a diagnosis?
Yeah, we always do the TI scout images, and we always pick the null point and do for every case, including amyloid. And finally, for every case, we rely on the PSIR.
Okay. Yes. I think that's what most of our experience has been as well. That gives us the best appearance. The you mentioned some very interesting points about mapping and how it was useful in not just between AL and TTR, but also in terms of quantification. There was a very interesting article by Bani Prasad in Circulation back in Cardiovascular Imaging in 2013, where he also was talking about using ECV as a marker for quantifying amyloid. And I think you mentioned that. But yes. What do you do, what is your recommendation to places which do not have mapping? So when have you found mapping to make a subtle difference between your confidence? And when have you, or does mapping really help you? Once you made the diagnosis of amyloid on CMR, does mapping add, say, more icing on the cake, as it were, or does mapping actually help you make a diagnosis as well? What is your recommendation to those who don't have mapping?
Yeah, I think, like you said, adding icing to the cake is one thing, and increasing our confidence. But I think most of the times we kind of, so we are reporting on PACS, so we will not initially have the mapping images on PACS. We will have to go to the workstation to see. So mostly we'll be seeing the routine images and making the diagnosis. And then we'll just go and do the mapping, like post-process the mapping to kind of increase our confidence. So we'll say, this is amyloid, but we'll go and see, yes, it is very high. So it is kind of increasing our confidence level more than actually helping in diagnosis. But we have used it in a few patients where we could not give gado because of renal failure and amyloid was very much suspected. So in such situations we have used it, and we like without the LGE, with the very high T1 values, we have kind of said it's likely to be amyloid. And for centers who do not have mapping, I think the TI Scout is the one that is the very helpful thing, which all of us have. Everybody has the TI Scout images. So that is like whatever surrogate for the mapping.
Aparna, Raymond Kwong in 2015 had an article in the American Journal of Cardiology where he was actually talking about left atrial delayed enhancement as an important independent determinator predictor for diastolic dysfunction, particularly in patients with amyloid. And as we heard from Dr. Shirish, diastolic dysfunction is a problem in patients with amyloid as well. What has your experience been to look at atrial enhancement? And perhaps, do you just comment on it or do you actually use it to make any determination?
Yeah, we don't really have any experience with the prognosis part, but we always look for the atrial enhancement, atrial enlargement, dilatation and enhancement, and we particularly mention it. Like you said, that it is supposed to be a prognostic marker. And people say atrial involvement can be for two reasons. One is like the dilatation as well as enhancement. Because of the amyloid deposition in the atrial wall itself. And secondarily, because of the stiffness of the ventricle and increased filling pressures, the atrium is involved. So both ways, atrial involvement is supposed to be one of the bad prognostic markers, including a whole lot of, there are so many studies with so many prognostic markers. So at least the ones that we can see, we can actually mention in our report, I guess.
Do you see atrial enhancement frequently? So if you just had to pick sort of a 50% cutoff and say, is atrial enhancement seen in more than 50% of the patients of amyloid that you see, or less than 50%?
We do see it actually when we look for it. Maybe we should know and look for it, then we will see it more often. But I'm not really sure about the 50%. Maybe I'll set on 50%.
Okay. So it's not seen in all patients of amyloid, I guess.
No, not all. But we do, like if we look for it, we do find it. It's not uncommon, I think.
And I guess in a similar vein, because right ventricle enhancement is something which is somewhat difficult for us to determine, just because it's such a thin ventricle. Do you see right ventricular enhancement frequently with amyloid?
Yeah, I think again, like if you look for it, and many times we do see the RV wall thickening also. So once it is thickened, I think it's more easier to see the enhancement. So we do see it. Yeah.
Thank you, Aparna. That was a fantastic lecture. And again, thank you for being part of this panel.
Thank you.
It gives me great pleasure to bring our third speaker on, Dr. Julie Hepzibah from Nuclear Medicine, and she's going to give us the nuclear perspective. And Dr. Julie and Dr. Aparna, I guess one question which I've kept to the end of it is, particularly at your institution, how you would finally decide whether a person needed a nuclear medicine study or whether the person needed a CMR or perhaps both. So perhaps you could shed some light on that after Dr. Julie's talk is over. Dr. Julie, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjaya. Is my screen visible?
Yes, Dr. Julie, you are visible and it's very clear as well. The voice is clear.
Good evening, everyone. And today I will talk on the role of nuclear imaging in cardiac amyloidosis. And my two previous speakers, they had given an excellent talk, and I will try to see how we can make this complex diagnosis of amyloidosis simplified. I'll try my best, and here we go. So this is the outline of my talk. I'll be talking on the nuclear imaging principles and the non-amyloid specific and amyloid specific tracers and how we can interpret the image and the semi-quantitative analysis. So we all know cardiac amyloidosis is an infiltrative cardiomyopathy, and the deposition of the amyloid fibrils within the extracellular space is the hallmark of the cardiac amyloidosis. And this is caused, as Dr. Suresh had already explained, by the misfolding of precursor proteins and commonly the ATTR, that is transthyretin transport protein synthesized in the liver, or monoclonal light chains produced by an abnormal plasma cell clone. So our interest in nuclear medicine, especially the planar imaging, is more towards the ATTR. So this slide illustrates the present and the future of ATTR cardiomyopathy with respect to the epidemiology, diagnostic approach and treatment. So if you look at the epidemiology, in the last 15 to 20 years, there has been a significant increase in the number of cases, possibly because people are aware of it, or all these years perhaps it was misdiagnosed or not diagnosed. And then there's this non-invasive scintigraphy, which is the diagnostic counterpart of it. And recent years there has been significant interest in the nuclear imaging for amyloidosis. And what we're going to look at. So when there is a high suspicion for cardiac amyloidosis based on the history or the ECG, and as we saw echo and MR, we go ahead with nuclear scintigraphy. And along with that, we need to always work up for the AL type of amyloidosis, which we have already listed. And so there are four scenarios which we can get when the nuclear imaging is positive and there is no gammopathy. So definitely we can say that ATTR amyloid is present and we need to do the TTR genotyping. And if scintigraphy is positive and gammopathy also is positive, it has to be a multidisciplinary approach engaging hematologists, cardiologists and the others to evaluate for the cause of cardiac amyloidosis. If scintigraphy is negative and gammopathy is positive, definitely go in for biopsy of the clinically affected organ, including heart. And if both are negative, then we can be sure that there is no cardiac amyloidosis. So coming to nuclear imaging, what are the imaging targets in cardiac amyloidosis? It can be broadly divided into two, that is non-amyloid specific bone avid tracers and amyloid specific radiotracers. So amyloid specific bone avid, you can do both planar imaging or SPECT, that is single photon emission computed tomography. This is effective in detecting TTR myocardial deposits. And amyloid specific radiotracers, mostly are positron emitting tracers, that is fluorine 18 and carbon 11. Now fluorine 18 can be available, but as I'm going to mention, this fluorine 18 tracers, fluor beta pen, and flutamethol is not available in our country, but those are one of the best amyloid binding tracers. And carbon 11 is again not really available. It's a Pittsburgh compound, and we all know that positron emitters have a very short half-life. Therefore, we should have an in-house cyclotron to get all these tracers. Now, coming to bone avid radio tracers, they're technetium-based, technetium-99m-based bone avid tracers. They can be DPD, that is diphosphenopropanodicarboxylic acid, or HMDP, that is hydroxymethylene diphosphonate, and technetium pyrophosphate. Technetium pyrophosphate is the most commonly used, and this can permit diagnosis of ATTR without a tissue biopsy. Now, what is the mechanism of myocardial uptake in ATTR? It is not yet clear, but it is possibly related to binding of radio tracer to microcalcification, which is found more abundant in ATTR than AL fibrils. Now, looking at this slide, as Dr. Suresh had mentioned, in amyloidosis, there is increased LV mass without hypertrophy. So you can see that the amyloid fibril deposits are in between the myocardial cells. There is no hypertrophy of the myocardial cells. And this will cause low voltage ECG. And this on echo, you will get on echo or CMR, there will be increased LV wall thickness and there's extra cardiac volume expanded. Now the amyloid traces, as I mentioned before, I summarize it to Pohnavi traces and other traces like technetium acrotinin and technetium SAP. PET traces are carbon 11, PIB, and F18, fluor betapril, betapenin, flutimetol. So to summarize all the molecular traces, bone seeking, and the most commonly used and the easily available is the pyrophosphate. And the other traces are indium antimyosin, which is not really available, and amyloid specific bindings like tioflavin T derivatives, carbon 11, F18, fluor betapril, and still being derivatives like fluor betapril and serine protease inhibitors. These are all not available, but it is good to know that these exist. So when there is characteristic feature on the echo and CMR, then a bone scintigraphy is asked for, and it is for cardiac amyloidosis study. And you can see here in this image, the heart is taking up quite a lot of tracer, and the SPECT image is showing definite activity, and there's no blood pool activity. It is mostly in the left ventricular myocardium. So what are the imaging parameters? One of the advantages of technetium pyrophosphate or Pohnavi traces is that you don't need any preparation. There's no fasting required, and the scan can be done as a rest scan. The dose is about 10 to 20 millicurie, which is given intravenously, and the time between injection and acquisition of scan is 1 hour post-injection for both planar and SPECT imaging. And optional is a 3 hour SPECT or planar. And we use the gamma camera, of course, for imaging. So the advantage of SPECT imaging is it avoids overlap of bone uptake, and it clearly distinguishes between the blood pool activity, and it assesses distribution of uptake, identifies uptake in the interventricular septum, which is commonly involved in amyloidosis, and definitely quantify degree of myocardial uptake in comparison to the rib uptake. So how do we grade it? Grade zero is that we will not see any myocardial activity. In grade one, the myocardial activity will be lesser than the rib uptake. In grade two, it will be equal to rib uptake, and grade three, more than rib uptake. And the semi-quantitative evaluation is by doing a heart to contralateral lung ratio. So if the heart to contralateral lung ratio is more than 1.5, then we can, and if there are, if the workup for AL is negative, then we can definitely be sure that it is an ATTR variant. And this is a SPECT visual score, almost similar to the planar visual scoring, grade 0, 1, 2, and 3. This is an example of a patient who had grade 3 tracer uptake on the planar imaging, and the heart to contralateral chest ratio was 1.79. And you can see that the multiplanar SPECT imaging showing myocardium and not the blood pool tracer uptake with some heterogeneity in uptake intensity. And this patient had coronary artery disease, was excluded by angiography. So you can definitely see that there's a significant uptake in the myocardium. So what are the cause of misdiagnosis in a amyloid scintigraphy with bone avid traces? Sometimes you may have a positive pyrophosphate scan, but it may not always be diagnosed as an ATTR amyloidosis. Therefore, we need to always screen for AL before we commit or comment on ATTR. And on to my right is a scan where on a planar imaging, we would have put it as positive scan. But when we do the SPECT, we know that there is, it's a blood pool uptake, and it was not the myocardium uptake. So it is very important to always perform SPECT imaging. So we must be sure to make an accurate diagnosis of a patient who presented with heart failure with typical echo and or CMR and negative serum free light chains and serum urine IFEs are negative, but the scan is positive, then we can accurately diagnose ATTR amyloidosis and hence perform TTR DNA sequence. And coming to this, the the image below. This is a patient with a negative scan, but still the clinical suspicion persists. So then go for a cardiac biopsy. And in this patient, it was proven to be an ATTR variant. And so the lesson that we learn is perform biopsy if there is a strong clinical suspicion of cardiac amyloidosis, irrespective of whether there is a negative pyrophosphate imaging. So again, reiterating on the false positive technetium pyrophosphate imaging, AL can most of the time give a negative imaging, sometimes can have positive scan also. And blood pool uptake in the planar, so do a SPECT. And rib fractures, they can overlap because it's a bone avid tracer, so they will be hot on the scan. So do a SPECT image again. And acute or subacute myocardial infarction also can pick up pyrophosphate. And sometimes in hydroxychloroquine cardiac toxicity and other rare forms of CA. So recognizing that a single test alone does not establish or exclude the diagnosis of ATTR is central to the proper application of technetium pyrophosphate or any of the bone avid tracer scintigraphy in the appropriate clinical context. So what are the advantages of imaging over endomyocardial biopsy in cardiac amyloidosis? So for technetium pyrophosphate, there's high specificity for ATTR because of the increased level of microcalcification. And of course, PET utilization increases the sensitivity. There's higher sensitivity at 1 hour imaging and higher specificity at 3 hour imaging. It is widely available, non-invasive. We can get semi-quantitative parameters and it provides whole heart imaging to estimate cardiac amyloid burden and can be easily and successfully repeated to assess response to therapy. And pyrophosphate, technetium pyrophosphate is something that will be available in all nuclear medicine centers. So again, coming to how do we interpret? So the myocardial pyrophosphate uptake patterns can either be absent, focal, or diffuse. We have semi-quantitative and quantitative analysis. I had already mentioned about grade 0, 1, 2, and 3. You can see no uptake, a normal bone uptake is 0, uptake less than rib, 1. Uptake equal to rib uptake is 2 and uptake greater than rib is grade 3. So coming to quantitative, how do we do it is the myocardial uptake contralateral lung ratio at 1 hour. We draw a circular region of interest over the heart on the planar images and it's mirrored over the contralateral chest. The mean counts are measured in each of the ROI and the ratio is taken. And if it is more than 1.5, it is more in favor of a ATTR. And this is an image showing a patient, a biopsy proven ATTR with heart contralateral lung ratio 2.08. So what is the guideline for reporting a technetium pyrophosphate imaging? So it can be broadly classified into categories. One is not suggestive of ATTR. That is when there is semi-quantitative visual score of 0 or HCL ratio is less than 1, and then strongly suggestive is semi-quantitative visual score of 2 or 3 and a HCL ratio more than 1.5. When it's equivocal, it's a visual score of 1 or HCL ratio 1 to 1.5. Then we have to interpret the results in the context of prior evaluation. That is, if echo and CMR are strongly positive and pyrophosphate is negative, then you have to consider further evaluation, including endomyocardial biopsy. And we need to emphasize the importance of excluding a monoclonal process with serum and urine immunofixation and the serum free light chain assay in all patients with suspected amyloidosis referred for pyrophosphate scan, irrespective of the scan results. And equivocal results could represent AL amyloid or early ATTR cardiac amyloid. So this was one of our patients who was a 50-year-old lady. And you can see that she had atrial fibrillation with slow ventricular response and the ECG showed low voltages. There was a high suspicion for amyloidosis. And you can see that there's a diffuse uptake in the heart and the semi-quantitative interpretation in relation to rib uptake was grade 2 and the heart to contralateral lung ratio for this patient was more than 1.5. And there's another patient where there was a high suspicion for amyloidosis, but we could not see that this was a positive study. This was a negative study, so we had further workup is pending on this patient, so I'm not able to comment completely on this diagnosis. So what is the sensitivity and specificity of the radionuclide bone scintigraphy cardiac imaging compared with the endomyocardial biopsy histology? So this was a study done by Gilmore et al. In 2016, they had published, and they said, if in grade 1, 2, or 3, the ATTR amyloid deposit, the sensitivity will be about more than 99% with a low specificity. However, when the grade is 2 or 3, the sensitivity increases and the sensitivity decreases, but the specificity definitely increases. The positive predictive value for cardiac ATTR amyloid combination of grade 2 or 3 cardiac uptake on a nucleate scan and absence of a detectable monoclonal protein was 100%. So coming to amyloid specific probes, I already spoke about carbon 11 and F18. The most commonly used one abroad, wherever it is approved, it is the Fluor Beta Prep. Initially, it was started as a imaging for Alzheimer's. In 2012, it was approved by FDA. And this tracer images the amyloid protein itself. Therefore, it has high affinity and specificity for beta amyloid fibrils. So here, the amyloid light chain is much more, the uptake in amyloid light chain cardiomyopathy is much more than ATTR. And this is administered intravenously, and F18 has a very, Fluor Beta Prep has very good pharmacokinetics, and we all know F18 half-life is 110 minutes or 109 minutes. Therefore, it can be easily transported even to a place within the reach of the radio tracer. There's a cyclotron in the nearby town or city. So this is an image of F18 Fluor Beta Prep in the image to my left. There's diffuse intense myocardial uptake in the patient with cardiac AL amyloidosis undergoing first cycle of chemotherapy. The middle image shows marked intense myocardial uptake with Fluor Beta Prep in a patient with cardiac AL amyloidosis prior to chemotherapy initiation. And the last image shows diffuse low-grade myocardial uptake in a patient with cardiac AL in a complete clonal response 3 months after completion of chemotherapy. So this clearly demonstrates how this imaging is excellent for even response assessment. So a caution, a negative pyrophosphate technetium scan does not exclude cardiac amyloidosis. As you see here in this patient, it's a bone scan where you're not seeing any uptake in the myocardium. So this is an image that I had picked from this journal, this article by Sharmila Dorbala. And they've done Fluor Beta Prep as part of a research protocol, and they demonstrated that there's intense myocardial uptake and the parotid uptake in the F18 Fluor Beta Prep image. So one of the advantages is that you can do a whole body imaging with any of these tracers, not just confined to the heart, so that you can also identify other systemic involvement of amyloidosis. So I would like to conclude by saying that cardiac amyloidosis is a lethal cause of cardiomyopathy if left untreated. And diagnosing ATTR requires a high index of suspicion, and it can be made non-invasively with nuclear scintigraphy when there is no evidence of a monoclonal protein. And technetium 99 label bone avid tracers are very useful for diagnosing ATTR. AL must be excluded, and biopsy is required if a monoclonal protein is present. And SPECT imaging is essential to confirm myocardial uptake. And the recent tracers that are there have shown very promising results in the diagnosis of amyloidosis, cardiac amyloidosis. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Julie. That was an excellent presentation. You took us very nicely through the types of radio tracers that are used you describe the quantification process, how you quantify the imaging, and you also made a comment. Can you please come on the stream dais, Dr. Julie? I would request you to turn your video camera on. And you also mentioned very nicely about the high specificity of the of technetium pyrophosphate and the bone tracers for ATTR. I think the last couple of slides were actually very informative as well, in the fact that you can actually monitor response to therapy. I thought that was something which is very interesting. So there are a couple of questions, and as radiologists, you know, we are always asked about radiation dose, and we know that nuclear medicine is not without its own radiation dose. So can you comment very briefly on radiation dose and your techniques?
So for the pyrophosphate image, there's a very modest exposure to radiation. It's about anywhere between 3 millisieverts to 7 millisievert of radiation exposure in one imaging. That is about the planar imaging. Well, coming to the PET, definitely a PET involves a higher radiation exposure. It can be anywhere between 16 to 24 millisieverts, depending on where, how much of, like whether you're doing a whole body imaging or just a regional imaging. If it's a whole body imaging, definitely it is going to be 16 to 24 millisieverts. That's the radiation exposure that you can expect in a whole body PET CT. But in a pyrophosphate, it's not as much. And since technetium pyrophosphate is, you know, it can be easily treated out of the system once a patient is hydrated well and voids frequently. So there's not much of a fear of radiation exposure to the individual as such in the technetium pyrophosphate.
Thank you, Dr. Julie. So is it possible, and you had mentioned whole body imaging is another option in many of these radio tracers. So obviously the specificity is extremely high for cardiac amyloid. How could we be able to relate that to, say, looking for amyloid in other organs?
So pyrophosphate very specific for cardiac, but it's not studied for the other systemic amyloidosis. However, PET is something that is really coming up, and I'm sure in a few years' time we will be having these tracers that is very specific for beta amyloid. And not just for cardiac amyloidosis per se, but interest in Alzheimer's and aging disorders have come up in a big way. So I am very optimistic that these tracers will very soon come into our country and definitely create a big impact in terms of diagnosis of amyloidosis and other diseases. So PET tracers definitely are useful and will definitely help us in diagnosing the other systemic involvement in amyloidosis.
Thank you, Dr. Julie. Can I request Dr. Aparna and Dr. Shirish to also turn on the videos and join the discussion? Dr. Shirish, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here, sir. My video, for some reason, is not.
That's not a problem. Not a problem. So I'm going to let you have some of the last words on the discussion. You have to choose now between Dr. Aparna and Dr. Julie. Who would you choose? Obviously, I'm discussing, the question is more related to which imaging you prefer, not the person themselves.
As, I mean, as the discussion went on, they're complementary imaging, so not that we have to choose. Most of the times, we don't have to choose between them. MRI, most of the patients undergo an MRI in our institution because it gives additional information in terms of structural abnormalities as well as LG in addition to the echo. Now, only if we don't have AL amyloidosis when we are negative, do we go to ATTR. So we do a pyrophosphate scan. So if there is evidence of circulating light chain excess, then most likely we will not do a pyrophosphate scan. So only in those situations where it is negative do we go. So in fact, in Dr. Julie's slide, where it is actually, if you do it before, in fact, the recommendations from the cardiology perspective that do not do a pyrophosphate scan before there is negative evidence of circulating immunoglobulins. If it is negative only, do go for a pyrophosphate scan. So in fact, one of those slides where both are positive, it confuses us more, and you need a multidisciplinary approach and all. So probably it's better to use in patients who are negative for immunoglobulins rather than directly in addition to it. That's what I feel.
I found the the options to actually monitor treatment to be a fascinating use of nuclear medicine. We've all read about amyloid being a potentially reversible process, that there is some reversibility, but those images gave the appearance that it was almost completely reversible. How do you actually reconcile the fact that you're having such improvement on PET imaging in this patient with amyloid of the heart? Are you seeing the same in terms of their clinical improvement as well from a cardiac perspective, cardiology perspective?
The TTR amyloidosis, we do not have any experience, obviously, because we don't have the medications as of now in India. So still, ATTR patients are managed symptomatically only. So we do not have that experience with the ATTR amyloidosis. The AL amyloidosis, no, we do not routinely do this pyrophosphate scan. But echocardiographically, those who have been diagnosed early, already patients with this fluid features, they have extremely poor prognosis despite chemotherapy. Most of them do not live beyond 1 or 2 years. If they have fluid features like all the systemic features, renal dysfunction, severe LVH. But those who have been picked up early, they do show, at least a small proportion of them do show regression of echocardiographic findings also. And some of them, if not regression, at least they will not worsen after the starting of chemotherapy. But most patients who already have severe heart failure with advanced disease, they do poorly despite most of them do die quite early. They don't have experience.
Well, it's my pleasure to thank Dr. Aparna, Dr. Julie, and Dr. Shirish for an excellent presentation. It's always nice to have a situation where they all come from the same institution. And I think that camaraderie is reflected very clearly in terms of the understanding of treatment. And essentially, as imagers, we all live for the fact that the patient gets treated appropriately. So I think CMC has more than lived up to its motto of not to be ministered onto, but to rather minister all the audience. And as an audience member and as the moderator, I have the greatest pleasure to thank all of you and to now hand it back to Dr. Priya to complete the session.
Thank you very much, sir. It was really an academic feast. All the faculties were really good. I learned a lot. And no textbook chapter would be complete, with comprehensive, with clinical, radiological, and nuclear medicine. The range of topic was really very good. So our next session will be in the second week of May, and it is going to be on role of nuclear cardiology in current era of cardiac CT and MR. And Dr. Sharmila Dorbala from Harvard Medical School will be taking the session. In case if there are any suggestions for the next topic, please do let us know. Thank you. Good night, everyone.
And a round of applause to the speakers again. Thank you again, and good night to all of you.
Thank you. Good night. Good night.